Good morning, everyone. Honorable guests, distinguished guests, professors, students, welcome to TechSim 2020, day two of the two-day-long session. We'll start today's session with a keynote lecture by Professor Monica Agarwal from IIT Delhi. So the keynote lecture focuses on underwater communication and open challenge by Professor IIT Delhi, and she's also advisory committee member of TechSim 2020. She received the BTech degree in Electrical Engineering and MTech degree in Electronics and Communication Engineering from the Regional Engineering College, Kurukshetra, India, and PhD degree from Indian Institute of Technology at IIT Delhi, India. She was employed in Hughes Software System, HSS, in Gurgaon from 1999 to 2002. In 2001, she was a visiting researcher in the Department of Systems and Control in Uppsala University, Uppsala, Sweden. She joined CARE IIT Delhi as assistant prof in Jan 2003. She works in digital signal processing with applications to array signal processing and underwater acoustics and communication. Ma'am, please.
Good morning, all of you. And thanks for inviting me here and giving this opportunity to speak about something which is very close to me. Before I begin, I would like to thank all of the organizers who have done this, put so much effort, especially Dr. Venkatesh, who has invited me and who has been following us from the day we started our MTS. MTS, we'll talk about later. So let's just start with the underwater communication. Okay, so what is underwater communication? Anybody? See, I'm a professor, so I will be different from the last day speakers. So I'll ask you to answer my things and want to be more interactive. So what is underwater communication? It's a communication between two objects which are in the water, all the time in the water. You have our phones, we communicate. We talk to our friends over the phone. So how do we talk? Our phones are on the ground and we communicate. So for that communication, we use EM waves, electromagnetic waves. That is why your parents ask you, please keep the phone away. You should sleep without your phone so that the EM wave should not affect you. But in the water, EM waves cannot propagate. So we require some other mediums to communicate. Okay, another basic thing that we have is, why do I need this underwater communication? We live on the ground, but then why do I need to communicate in the water? As yesterday people were saying, 70% of the earth is water. So water is part of the earth we are living on. And if we are on the water, we should not be hanged, we should be communicating. There are so many creatures present in the water, we want to know it. There are specific applications which I start with. So basically, this underwater communication can help you in knowing about the sea that we have. All the mammals present there, all the things that we have. Sea is still unexplored thing to us. So as we go ahead, we might explore it. Presently, we do not have any medium to know. But if we can go down, take some pictures and send it online, we can do that. So people have deployed this underwater modem in the sea so that we can find out the things about the sea that we have. Tsunami is something, Chennai was the most affected. So tsunami warning is a warning system that you want all the time. Now if you have a manned system, it is not possible. If you have a system over the ground, it is difficult. You need a system submerged in the water to know about the tsunami. So for that also, you require something by which you can communicate. You can communicate from the water to the ground to know us that there is something happening and we want to take a corrective measure to it. In fact, people have designed, so AUVs is something which is coming up. So when the AUV maneuvers in the water, it will require to communicate. AUV, if you know, it's kind of a vehicle which moves in the water autonomously. You do not have a driver, it just moves around. So when it wants to communicate, because there is no tether attached to it, you require a wireless communication through it, and it is in the water, so you require an underwater communication. Same thing, you want to detect the objects, and there are some people who do diving. Scuba diving is, I think, very famous in Chennai and more famous in Sri Lanka. People go there for the holidays, for the scuba diving. How do they, anybody has done the scuba diving? Okay, yes. So how do you communicate when you do scuba diving? You just have sign languages to communicate. You cannot talk. If you talk, the instructor might be away and instructor will not receive what you are saying. So instructor gives you some 3-4 tips. You have to understand and only then you can do the scuba diving. So for that also, if we can provide a telephone, I have a telephone, I can talk to my mother in India, I mean in Delhi, and anybody around the world with the phone. So in the water, I'm just 1 mile away from the instructor and I'm still not able to talk. So that is the purpose that we require this underwater communication. Before I go ahead, I would like to say, see, all of us using Uber, Ola, it's a 5G or 4G app. A few days back when I was a student, there was no such app available. And for me, the taxi was, wow, what a thing. Even the auto is what I used to hire to communicate. But now the 4G has given us the Uber and the Ola, and it's so affordable. Because we had 4G, we could go for Ola. So once we have the technology, we have the applications that are written around it. So once we have the enabling technology of underwater communication, we can think of various things around it, and then the sky is the limit. Okay, so as I said, I just begin with some basics, maths, as we can go ahead. So as I said, EM waves is what cannot communicate in the water, because they get absorbed. Water is a medium which absorbs the EM wave. What you want is, you want to send the signal to a certain distance. So acoustics are the signals which travel. The light travels in the water. And a low frequency voice travels further. Even the light waves are also there. Light waves also travel. We'll touch upon these two as I go ahead. So I'll start with the acoustic communication. So actually, the history of it is very long. Sharbari might correct me. So it basically, the history is from 1400 century, when Leonardo da Vinci has done that communication. He took a small pipe and he could say that, okay, the voice traveled from one ship to another. But it took several decades or several centuries before the Newton came, and he gave a mathematical footing of it. And once we have a mathematical footing, till in 2020, I'm still talking about it as an open challenge. Still, there is a gap in this communication domain that we have underwater. Why? That is a challenge. Because the kind of environment the sea is very difficult. If you look at this, Okay, so basically what you have is, you have this environment. Underwater, it's a bounded medium. Unlike our RF signals, which is open. I go out and I talk, it's an open. Sometimes in the rooms, I do not get the signal. So underwater environment is kind of a... Okay, so underwater is a bounded medium. And then what happens is, you have a transmitter and receiver. This is the medium that we have to communicate. You have so many bounded mediums. So the bounded mediums gives you reflection. You go out, and when you were a kid, you were shouting at the mountains and the voice was coming back. That was the echo. And that is happening in underwater a lot. So basically, so signal becomes a multipath. What you transmit, you do not get that. You get a several reflections of that. Second problem that you have in the underwater is, it's not stable platform. Even if you kind of make it a stationary environment, the ships that you are having is moving with the waves on it. So the transmitters that you have, the receiver that you have, is having a Doppler. I think all of you have heard that train going and train coming example. So as the train approaches and the train recedes, the sounds are different because the frequencies are changing with the Doppler. So that phenomenon is very much there in the underwater. Now, why this problem is there in the underwater, not in our buses that we do? I can communicate very easily even if I drive at 60 kilometers per hour or 100 kilometers per hour in my car. But underwater, this is a problem. Why the problem is? Because the rate of the carrier, the speed of the carrier. The light waves travel at a much larger rate as compared to the acoustics. So if the speed is high, the Doppler is not that much significant, whereas the acoustics, the Doppler becomes much more significant. It's basically to do with the frequency with which I'm working. I want a low frequency to be transmitting because the low frequencies reach to the destination. The another problem that we have is the sea mammals and the other sounds that the other ships are generating. They are also acoustic signals. So now what I'm transmitting is acoustic. I'm talking to you and some fan is working, somebody is talking. So my voice gets interfered with that person. So those same things are being affected in the underwater also. So the kind of signal I get, it's become a hodgepodge. And I, even if I talk to you, sometimes on the ship, you will not be able to understand. I think my friends from the ship can support me. It becomes very difficult and very challenging to talk over the ship. So that even if I go on the ship, I will not be able to stable because so what about the systems that we are having over there? So that becomes is a challenging environment that we have. So if I actually go into the maths and study the environment, so this is what I have plotted, the dependence of the frequency. See, ultimately when I go for 5G and 4G, I'm just using 5G and 4G because of two reasons. One, I'm part of that 5G team that IIT Chennai is doing. Second is because we are more familiar with these technologies. All of us have a 4G phone, I think, and all are aspirant of 5G things. Now, where in 5G, we go for gigahertz, definitely. And we are aspiring for terahertz for 6G, that is what we have. So these are the frequencies that we have. But when we go in the water, we are still in kilohertz. I only say I have 2 kilohertz, 4 kilohertz, 6 kilohertz. This is the bandwidth and the center frequency that I have. Why do I have this? Because the kind of channel I have, my absorption in the channel is increasing with the frequency. My absorption is increasing, so what does it mean? If I send a signal, I cannot get back the same frequency. So I get a very less bandwidth. My bandwidth is dependent upon the range. Suppose I ask you to transmit for 5 kilometers. I use different frequencies and I get different bandwidth. And if I want to transmit for 100 kilometers, I get a different frequency and I have to work for the different bandwidth. So all this is important when I design the system. Sound velocity, it is not constant in the water, though we assume it. So it's changing. It changes with so many parameters, salinity, temperature, depth, and so blah, blah, blah. So for me, the carrier that I use, it is not moving with the constant velocity. So where I place my transmitter and receiver, they will have different ways, how do they take the environment. Even the sound waves, they are not even the state, they are not like a state waves, they bend around the things. So they don't move, the sound waves do not move like a, they are the longitudinal waves. So they bend around the edges that you have. And again, you get another kind of problems that you handle. So this is a multipath, which I actually have discussed, that you have so many paths from the transmitter to the receiver. And what you get is a mixture of all that. The Doppler, as I said, you have different frequencies of train approaching and train receding. Same thing happens if your ship is moving, the transmitter is moving, the receiver is moving. This becomes very important in the case of AUVs because AUV is a moving vehicle. So how do we handle the Doppler there? This is a challenging job in the AUV thing. Then the noise. The noise is also not stationary. The noise is because, see, generally, if you are familiar with the statistical distribution, what we use is Gaussian as an assumption of all the noises that we have. Why do we use Gaussian? Because that is more natural phenomenon that happens. Second, it has a maximum entropy. There are certain reasons, scientific reasons to say that it is Gaussian. But in general, the noises are not Gaussian, mainly in the case of underwater. It is because, see, the Gaussian is something which is not very shrill. If I bang the door, I get a very shrill noise and it lasts only for small time. So these are the noises which we generally have in the underwater environment. You have the ship, you have the underwater mammal, which only speaks for some time and then it goes off. Then you have even the ship that machinery is generating comes and goes. So all these things makes it difficult to model the noises in underwater. So things are very different. Things are very different from the RF communication. That is why we could use RF and reach to, say, gigahertz. Now we are talking about the gigahertz, isn't it? But in underwater, we are still struggling to get kilobits of communication rate. Okay, so this is the graph that I wanted to show that. So this is how my range and the rate will decrease. So if I increase my range, my rate has to decrease. There is no way that I can combat my rate if at a higher ranges. So I have to kind of work with a smaller data rate if I go for a larger range. So how do I combat these things? I require many signal processing techniques. Then, now it's a wave that propagates. So I require a rugged wave theory to begin with. So basically, I require four components to design an underwater communication system using acoustics. So I require a signal processing, I require wave theory, I require some information theory, because what we transmit is only the information. And I require some diversity. So that if I say, see why the teacher says everything two times, because they want something to be registered in the student's mind. So you repeat the things to make it to make it more emphasize on it, and also to get registered as it is, so that the error is less. So that is a diversity. I want to have a diversity into it. So I think I'll ask Sharburi to explain it, all these things in the details, but I just go ahead with the MIMO system. So that is what a MIMO system is, that I require larger number of transmitters and a receiver. Now, as I said, larger number of transmitters. Having one transmitter is actually difficult. It's something like a geometry that I'll put on a ship and on the both transmitter and the receiver ship. Now, the ship is moving. Having one transducer underwater is very costly. Now, how do I have a multiple number of transmitters? And how do I maintain them? Maintain it, because they'll be in the water all the time. The second problem that I have is they will not be stable. So what we have come up with, a better solution, which is a vector sensor, which provides a diversity in terms of, not in terms of a spatial thing, but in terms of a dimension. When in the water, I have X, Y, and Z coordinates, so I send my signals in all the three coordinates and combine it to get a better performance. So with all this, we have done some sea experiment in Chennai only, with the Royapuram at Chennai. And we could get a good ranges. So if you are familiar with the communications, you actually know this diagram. So this is the four points you transmit. And in our case, we could get them better. But you will still feel that this point is mapped to this. It's still spread. But I know that it is more closer to this, so I can decode. So now my decoding and signal processing will work to give me a better reception. So this is the environment over which we have tested. So we took a boats only, and we just lowered the cable and did the test, and we got a successful results. And our this modem is as good as what you have in the international market. If you compare, the performance is as good. The benefit is it is being tested in Indian waters. So saying this, I come to another thing. I think I have time. I just come to another thing which is important, which is a light waves. As I said before, I do not communicate using acoustics. I can even communicate the lights. People use lights. I'll just skip maybe. I'll just come to this. So lights, people in the Navy, they use a torch to see the objects. So they can see the object through the torch. Now, it's a light, it's a medium, it's an energy that is being transmitted. So why can't that energy be used to communicate? So that is what we are exploring. The only problems that you have is the kind of water we have, the kind of water, because the light, if it is turbid water, if it is not clear water, the light cannot propagate with distance. If it is chlorophyll there, the light gets attenuated. It cannot reach far. So the only problem that you have is the distance. But it's a light wave. So now the velocities that I'm talking about is again the velocities of EM. So I can get the same bandwidth. I can get a larger data rate. So to make it more compatible. So what I want is, in the end, a combined system. I want to have a sensor network kind of a system where I have some acoustic communication and some light communication, and I can secure my ships in the water. I can secure my boundaries. So with that, I'll end. I'll ask Sharbari to kind of give you insights about the techniques of signal processing that we are handling over it. Thank you.
I'd now like to call upon Dr. Sharbari Banerjee. Dr. Sharbari Banerjee is an assistant professor at Amity University, Noida. She has completed her PhD from Center for Applied Research in Electronics, IIT Delhi. She is actively involved in research and development activities on underwater acoustics communication with Dr. Manika Agarwal. I kindly invite them up on the stage.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to begin by thanking the organizers for organizing such a wonderful event and giving me an opportunity to present something about underwater communication. I've been working in this area for the last 10 years, and today I would like to talk about the advanced techniques to mitigate two prevalent issues in underwater communication. One is the multipath, another is the noise. So Monica ma'am has given a good introduction to build out the fact that underwater communication channels are not easy to handle. We have several issues in our hands. So amongst the several issues, I will address only two issues and the signal processing techniques that we use to handle these issues. So this is briefly the structure of my presentation. So let's start. The key issues in a broader scale that we have in underwater communication these days is, one, the data rate, and reliability. When I say reliability, I mean probability of error. Suppose I transmit something, how much likely it is to receive the actual data that I am transmitting. So the reliability aspect of underwater communication is affected by two issues. One is the multipath structure available in the channel. So when I say multipath structure, suppose we are sitting in this room, I'm talking to you, how my speech is being received by you. Whatever I am speaking, it's getting reflected from the walls and around all the obstacles in the room, and that's how it reaches you. Now, this room is fixed. All the side walls and everything is fixed. So whatever I am speaking, the time it takes to reach you is affected by all the reflections. So it will need some specific amount of time to have all the reflections of whatever I am speaking here. But when we talk in the when we communicate in an underwater medium, the medium is not fixed. It's continuously changing. The reflections that we are having from the bottom, that might be fixed, but the reflections that we are having from the surface or the sides are continuously changing. So naturally, the multipath structure that we encounter in an underwater channel is much more severe than what we can have in a wireless link, or so to say, in a mobile communication link. Another problem is the noise. Noise, as ma'am mentioned, typically we consider the noise to have a statistics which is Gaussian statistics. But when we come underwater, for different reasons, I will mention the reasons, the noise is no more Gaussian. So striking an optimum balance between data rate, till now we had a problem of striking an optimum balance between data rate and reliability. Now we are, while dealing with reliability in an underwater channel, we are seeing that it's not as simple as dealing it in an underwater, in a wireless channel, because we can't just pick. See, the wireless channel is much more established, or the wireless communication links are much more established. So it could have been an easier option for us, ke whatever the techniques are used in wireless communication, just pick them and use it underwater. What's the big deal? But we can't do that, because as the channel changes, its properties changes, the assumptions we take traditionally are not same in an underwater channel. Suppose for a wireless link, the multipath structure lasts for around only a few symbol intervals, which will be in the order of some nanoseconds or microseconds. But if we talk underwater, depending on the data that we are using, the multipath can actually last up to several hundreds or thousands of symbol intervals. And the noise, again, the non-Gaussian noise. So what we are looking for is to establish a wireless communication link which can give us reliable communication when my channel undergoes or my underwater channel undergoes severe multipath and the noise in the channel is impulsive in nature. So first, let's see how we are combating the multipath problem. We use a concept called time reversal mirror. So what happens in case of an ordinary mirror is, whatever the incident signal, it's reflected back in an opposite direction. We all know that. We have a mirror, the signal is incident, and then it is reflected back in an opposite direction. Now, time reversal mirror is a concept. We won't have a physical mirror in the market like this. So it's a concept which says that instead of getting the signal signal reflected in the opposite direction, the signal will be reflected back in the same direction. So this might give us some benefit if we use it in a communication medium. How? Typically, how communication occurs? I'm standing here, I'm speaking, you are receiving, right? So I'm the transmitter, you are the receiver. So whatever I'm speaking, throughout this entire communication medium, throughout the reflections from the surface and the bottom and the side walls, it creates a multipath structure and it receives at the receiver. So when we are at the mountains, we get the echoes are, the echoes are actually audibly so distinct that we can hear it. But when we are in such a small distance, we can't actually hear our echoes distinctly. The echoes are still there, but the nature of this channel is such that it's arriving to all of you at the same point of time, so you can't distinguish. But if we go to the mountains, we can actually distinguish those echoes. And this is what is happening here. We transmitted one single wave, and from the reflections from the surface and the bottom, it has reached the receiver at different points of time. What will happen if this thing happens? My signal will obviously get attenuated. It will be more affected by noise, and we will have higher error probability. I will transmit something and something else will be received. How we encounter this? Suppose we take a reciprocal medium. Reciprocal medium means, even if we interchange the position of the transmitter and the receiver, the medium is not going to change. This is the only assumption that we are making. We interchange the location of the transmitter and the receiver, the channel is not going to change. Now, within such a medium, suppose we have a similar transmitter array and a receiver. Instead of transmitting from the transmitter end, first we do is, we transmit a signal from the receiver end. It's a probe signal. So this signal, due to the multipath structure, is received at different points of the transmitter array at different points of time. So we can exploit this received signal to get the channel state information. It's like, suppose you are traveling from IIT Chennai to Chennai airport. There can be hundreds of different ways to reach from this place to the airport. Some places will be more congested, some routes will be more congested, some routes will be less congested. So instead of taking the less congested route, if we take the more congested route, we'll be exhausted by the end of it, right? We won't reach on time. So what we can do is, we can just give a call to someone or someone who has traveled the route this way or that way, from airport to IIT or from IIT to airport. We can give a call to that person, ask him, what's the status of the routes, which one is less congested, which one is more congested, and accordingly we can choose our route. So this is something like that. We have used the probe signal to get information about the channel, which is called the channel state information. Now at the transmitter end, we know the channel. We have placed, suppose we can place a time reversal mirror kind of a thing at the transmitter. So what will the time reversal mirror do? It will reflect the signals back in the same way that it has come from. So we have placed a time reversal mirror at the transmitter. The signal will be reflected back on the same path it has taken. And since we started from the receiver location, now it will reach the receiver in a more efficient way. So in this way, my signal will be directly focused on to the receiver. It will improve the signal to noise ratio, so which will lead to less error in my signal. So this is called the spatio-temporal focusing tool. The signal is focused in space and time both. So if we, I'm not going into the mathematical details of how we got this and all. So if we want to implement this, this effect of time reversal onto a communication link, it will be implemented in the form of a filter or, so to say, a system, which can be mathematically represented by a simple time reversal. You have ht, you take h of minus t, and a complex conjugation operation. That's it. That's all mathematics that we need for this system to work. So this is another benefit, is this system is mathematically very simple. It gives you an effective results, but does not incur any kind of computational complexity. So we have built up an experimental setup in underwater lab at CARE. And this is basically the transmitter and the receiver side. So only change we have done is in this. So only change that we have done, we will do is this medium. In CARE, in the underwater facility that we have at Center for Applied Research in Electronics, IIT Delhi, we have a small tank facility. So we do all our experiments over there and we test it outside. So what we initially did was, we did a CISO system trial. CISO system means we have a single transmitter and a single receiver just to check out whether my system is working or not. So this diagram, it shows the multipath structure of my channel. The peaks that we have is the direct path. And we can see this thing is prevalent for quite some time. The spread of the multipath is more than 8 milliseconds in time. So within this channel, if I'm transmitting this image, and this is a simple communication, I have not used any TR or anything, this is what we receive. If we are not using any time reversal communication, the transmitted image is distorted like this. Whereas if we use the time reversal technique, this is what we get. A much more better reception, a much more less erroneous reception. So this was just one instance. So we thought, why not we keep on trying it out at different locations for different data rates, for different other combination of the transmitter and the receivers. So what we did a MISO system trial. MISO system is multiple inputs and single output. We have multiple transmitters and a single receiver, the one which was resembling this diagram. Okay. So we did the MISO system trials here at Raipuram, Chennai, where we have seen that using time reversal mirror, we can actually achieve a communication range of 1.2 kilometers, where when we are talking of 1.2 kilometers, if we don't, we use a time reversal technique, whatever data that we are sending and receiving, that data, we cannot decode it without any error. Absolutely, we cannot do anything. The entire data gets hodgepodged. Whereas if we use time reversal mirror and if we have a control over the data rate, then we can get errors in the order of 10 to the power minus 3. 10 to the power minus 3 means if I'm transmitting 1000 data bits, one bit will be affected amongst 1000 bits. So that is the order of 10 to the power minus 3. So these are the system trials that we have, or the achievements that we have gone through using time reversal recording. Next, we'll have the techniques that we have employed for noise. So as mentioned by ma'am, we have several sources of noise in an underwater channel. And why we assume everything to be Gaussian is actually a mathematical assumption, which says that if we have infinite number of sources of noise, it eventually turns out to be Gaussian. This is the general thing. Now, what happens in case of an underwater channel, there are some sources which are continuously there, which are the prevailing sources, like the surface waves, the surface agitation, the thermal noise or the turbulence, these things are continuously there. So they'll give us the continuous background noise. Apart from them, we have ship noise, which are like impulsive. It comes and goes. We have the noise from underwater mammals, the shrimp noise. So these kind of noise are the impulsive components of noise, which comes, lasts for very little time, and then it goes away. So we assume that a Gaussian traditionally we assume that a Gaussian distribution can model every sort of noise. But in case of underwater, what we have seen is, no, it cannot. Why it cannot? Because this impulsive noise, if we look at the probability density function of the noise, it leads to much heavier tail in the probability density function, which refuses to be Gaussian. As simple as that. It is not Gaussian. So the situation now here is, from the ages and ages of communication engineering and signal processing, we assume that every time our channel will have a Gaussian noise, and we have built our life around that assumption. All the signal processing techniques, all the communication techniques that we have developed are based on this preliminary assumption that the noise in the channel is Gaussian. And here we are in a situation where it has been given in literature. It's not just one experiment that we have run. It's given in literature that underwater noise cannot be modeled to be Gaussian. So what do? Can we use our traditional receivers? Can we not? So let's see whether we can use the traditional receivers, or what happens if we use a traditional receiver. This line, this one, these two lines are traditional receivers when used, suppose we have recorded some C noise. That noise is giving us some signal to noise ratio. These are the ideal curves, that if the channel noise is Gaussian, how my traditional receiver is going to perform. This is the curve. These are the same Gaussian noise receiver when exposed to an underwater environment. So what we can see is, for the same amount of permissible error rates, let's say we are permitting that we are okay with a system which will give 1 bit of error in 10,000 bit of transmission. For that, we can see that we expected our traditional receiver to perform it in 5 dB of less signal to noise ratio, which now it's not going. Now it's not performing like that. Now, when exposed to C noise, for the same error rate, my traditional receiver needs 5 dB or more than 5 dB of SNR for giving me the same quality of performance. So it is evident that my traditional receivers cannot perform. Again, this is one example. We have recorded some C noise and based on that. So we searched over literature, and we can find out that apart from a Gaussian distribution, C noise can be modeled by these three distributions: a generalized Gaussian distribution, Gaussian mixture distribution, biparameter Cauchy Gaussian mixture distribution, and there can be several other distributions as well. Okay, so each of these distributions have their own properties. One common thing amongst all these distributions if we look at the probability density function, we will have some parameter which will model the impulsiveness of the process which we want to model. So suppose for the generalized Gaussian distribution, we have this shape parameter beta, which gives us the kurtosis value. More the kurtosis, more impulsive is the noise. Similarly, for the Gaussian mixture distribution and the Cauchy Gaussian mixture distribution also, we have a mixing coefficient which mixes the distributions as per the impulsiveness of the noise. So how does this impulsive noise impact the behavior of our traditional receiver? We can see is, as kurtosis increases, suppose we are considering the first case, the generalized Gaussian case. As kurtosis increases, this is how my system was supposed, the traditional system was supposed to perform. And this is how my system is going to perform as my kurtosis increases. So we can see here that as kurtosis increases, the noise becomes more and more impulsive, the performance of my system gets worse and worse. Same observation with Gaussian mixture noise, same observation with biparameter Cauchy-Gaussian mixture noise, that more impulsive the noise is, worse is the performance of the traditional Gaussian noise receiver. So what we need to do is to develop impulsive noise receivers. We take on the criteria on which Gaussian noise receivers are built upon, which is the maximum likelihood criteria, and we, I'm not going into the mathematical details, this is just the final expression. We have two receivers, a generalized Gaussian noise receiver and a biparameter Cauchy-Gaussian noise receiver, whose mathematics is different from the mathematics offered by a AWGN receiver, and which should give us a better, we are expecting that this kind of a tuned receiver, which is more tuned to the noise, this can give us a better performance. So this is coming to this slide. This actually shows that if we use in a impulsive noise scenario or a C noise scenario, if we use a Gaussian, generalized Gaussian noise receiver, it can give us a performance improvement of 2.5 dB or 2 dB. And if we can use a Cauchy-Gaussian mixture receiver, it can give us actually a performance improvement as high as 15 dB. We can actually work with 15 dB less signal to noise ratio, which is a large improvement. So in the concluding remarks, I would just like to say that these are only two issues that we have talked about, noise and multipath. We have lots and lots and other issues like reliable communication in within networking, AUVs. We need to integrate sensing, communication and navigation technologies. So the challenges, the future challenges are even more. So we need larger participation from the community here to take more active participation in underwater communication, because it is a much unexplored area and the research challenges or the research problems are, you know, huge. So please come join the community and let's take underwater communication forward. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning, honorable and distinguished guests, professors and students. I'd like to apologize for the delay in inaugural session due to some unexpected events. On behalf of IIT Madras MTS Student Section, we extend a very warm welcome to the National Level Technical Symposium, TechSim 2020, jointly organized by Department of Ocean Engineering IIT Madras and MTS India Section. The two-day-long symposium aims at providing its members of academia and industry a common forum for information and idea exchange. I would now like to invite upon our honorable guest for the day to come upon the dais and occupy the distinguished chair. Chief Guest, Commander S. Ashok, Staff Officer Hull, Fortna, Chennai. Professor Monica Agarwal, Professor IT Delhi and Advisory Committee Member of TechSim 2020, Dr. R. Venkateshan, Chairman MTS India Section, and Mr. S. Sarvala Gopati, Joint Secretary IIT Madras MTS Student Section. We would now like to welcome our guest with a fruit basket. Thank you. I would now like to call upon Mr. S. Sarvala Gopati, Joint Secretary IIT Madras MTS Student Section, to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Ashish. Good morning to one and all. Today, we have a very dignitary chief guest, Commander S. Ashok, Staff Officer Hull, Flag Officer Commanding Tamil Nadu and Puducherry Naval Area. We also have here Dr. Venkatesan, Chairman MTS India Section, and Professor Monica Agarwal, Counselor IIT Delhi MTS Student Section. I extend my warm welcome to the chief guest and dignitaries on the dais. Welcome, sir.
Welcome, ma'am.
I also happy to welcome our beloved faculty officer, Professor Sana Siraj, and Dr. Vijay Kumar from the Department of Ocean Engineering, IIT Madras.
Welcome, sir.
I welcome counselors of MTS student sections and poster presentation participants of various institutions across India. I also welcome teachers and school students who are here to demonstrate their ideas in the form of models at SciTech Expo. I take this opportunity to welcome representatives from various industries and also warm welcome to our sponsors. I hope yesterday we had a great interactive session with eminent personalities from various industries sharing their thoughts and experience in the form of keynote lectures and panel discussion. Today is the academic day. We shall continue the session with academic experts from various institutions and research organizations to share their views and opinions with us. We are happy that we received about 23 posters in different themes like underwater communications, naval architecture, automation, and offshore structures. We shall also hear from our budding researchers under the verticals of robotics, transportation, agriculture, and safety systems. I am sure it will be exciting to us. We have arranged an interactive session with JEE 2019 toppers of IIT Madras, which shall provide guidance for them to prepare the entrance exams, and there shall be a tour to Ocean Engineering Department in the afternoon. Post lunch, we have a panel discussion in the theme of automation in marine application, with comprising of experts from IIT Madras, CSIR, NIOT, and IMU. We are concluding the symposium with validatory function at the end of the day, where the winners and runners of poster as well as the SciTech Expo will be announced. I hope today also we are going to enjoy the sessions. I once again welcome to all to the TechSIM 2020. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarva. Speaking about Marine Technology Society India section, since its inception, 103 events have been successfully conducted across the nation, TechSurge being the highlighted event. Here's a glimpse of the MTS India section activities in the form of this small video. would hear in brief about the MTS India section by the chairman, Dr. R. Venkatesan.
Morning, respected Chief Guest, Commander Ashok, Dr. Monica Agarwal, and Sarva Lokapati, and students and other invitees, my colleagues, and MTS counselors. It's really a great pleasure for me again to be with all of you for the second day of TechSIM. You would have seen the growth of MTS. The main focus of Marine Technology Society is connecting to the people and working towards marine technology. This is what we have been driving, and myself and Mr. Nandakumar, who is secretary, and other committee members of India section, we have been thriving to work on it. It's all collective efforts, what you have seen. And you would have seen 9 student sections, and all these counselors and the students, they are really working very hard. I am also part of many other technical societies like IEEE, Institution of Engineers, NACE, wherein I'm holding different position like executive committee member or something. I would really say that this is the one society which is really different from others. There is no conventional methodology adopted here. We have a program called TechSurge, wherein we invite at a particular topic. That's a TechSurge is a, if you see in the Marine Technology Society website, there are various TechSurge all over the world in different sections. We have about members in 37 countries and 53 student sections, and many other activities are happening. In TechSurge, we identify a topic. For example, we had TechSurge in 2016 and 18. We had a topic, once we identified marine SAR, that is marine search and rescue. You all would have seen aircraft falling into the sea, how the rescue takes place, how we work on it. So the importance here is we could bring the services like Coast Guard and Navy. They were with us. Thanks to the Chief Director General of Coast Guard and Vice Admiral of Navy, they were supporting us and involving students again. We had a poster competition, and we could invite students to come out with newer ideas, which were well appreciated. In the second TechSurge, we had on fishing technology. We know the fishermen, they require technology like what we are using. It's not available to them. They still use a conventional method. How do you make them to communicate? How do you work them? How do you safeguard their life? So we brought some experts from abroad, made them and showed them different tools. We brought administrators. We brought fishermen themselves. In one of the cases, we could identify unsung heroes like 5 fishermen. Their fishing boat had broken. They were holding a piece and floating for 5 days. Can you imagine 5 days floating at sea? And they were alive. And we announced in the TechSurge that here there are people who require help. And very rare, I've never seen a seminar like this where the industry came forward and they agreed to provide them a boat. I'm not joking, it's not an announcement just left. The boat was built. Within 3 months, the boat was handed over, and another company came forward to get communication equipment. I'm very glad that we come and maybe we discuss and go, but there is something more. We touch the society by such activity. That's again connecting people. Then we had Techathon. Techathon is such a thing where we identify, again bring school students and college students together. In the first occasion, we had maritime communication. We announced a competition, wherein the students have to see, we all know that satellite communication is very important when you go offshore or when you start sailing. Your mobile network coverage is not available. How do you communicate? How do you make them to communicate each other? So the students came with different ideas. 9 best ideas were selected, and we had a jury from Navy and their naval officers part of a committee. And 2 days with the talks and afternoon demonstration, the techniques like LoRa, a laser, optical techniques were shown to them, and some are getting developed into a product. And the next case, some of you had participated from your schools. We had a school event where about 450 school students had come to SRM last year, and about 89 project demos were provided by them. And we had just at the best school, that is DAV school in Velachery. They were the best student project award. See, in that way, we could motivate them to work. And TechSIM is unique of its kind, wherein, like yesterday I mentioned, for the people, by the people, it's all for the students, by the student, they themselves evolved it. We are all mentors, myself and Dr. Sanas Raj and others, Dr. Murali from IIT Madras, we are all mentors and supporting them. You all should congratulate Danish, Sarva Lokapati, Ashok, Neha, and Karthik and Manmadan, who else I missed? These are all the names I know, I've been troubling them, and they all have taken a lot of efforts. What we see today is not just an activity which has happened. It has evolved in the course of time. It has evolved communicating with them. You would see that we are having people sparing their time, valuable time with the family, coming and sitting here on Saturdays, Sundays. Why do they come? Why do they come and spend time? That is, they have a commitment to give back to the society. Today, what we are there, some of us in the dais, we have come mainly because of the society. This is one way we give back to the society. Motivate the youngsters. Even Commander Ashok was telling, how do you motivate youngsters to work on marine technology? We have dearth of technology and which is not coming towards. They are all getting into a different technique and technology. The wonderful talk we had, I have never seen such a simplified way acoustic communication is spoken by Dr. Monica and Dr. Sarbari. And like a school student, I was watching them the way. It's a simple talk from a school student to the master's and PhD level, they could communicate in a shorter span of time. I don't think anywhere else you will be able to understand about Gaussian, you'll be able to talk about EM, you'll be able to understand about acoustics. So you're all lucky, a few of them who could come over there. It's very unfortunate that many schools could not come mainly because of exam, otherwise there would have been a better response, but still, the organizers decided themselves that they wanted this many numbers only, which will help them to communicate. I appreciate, but they have succeeded in making you, all of you, to come over there. We also organize an underwater student autonomous underwater vehicle competition, AUV competition. It's all called underwater robot. Maybe whatever word I'm telling you can Google search and you'll get more information. Wherein in San Diego, they conduct every year AUVSI underwater robotic competition. I'm glad to say that from 2011, in fact, I pinned down one day when I was sitting at home and I showed to our director, he agreed. Our ministry is supporting today. We spend about 12 to 15 lakhs for sponsoring these school students, or college teams, comprising of 5 students, mechanical, electrical, electronics, coming together to develop an AUV. And they were deputed to go to San Diego. And the last 8 occasions, we had about 8 different college teams who have gone over there. And I'm glad that IIT Bombay could reach up to the finals, competing about 56 international universities and colleges from USA, Singapore, or Russia, China, Japan, many other places. That is what is the competence we have. You are all busy with your own curriculum and regular exam and regular activities. I know, I also teach here ocean policy. I know the compulsions and the time limitations we have. But given an opportunity, I'm damn sure that you all will exceed. Coming back to the 8 student sections, they are all taking different efforts, like Banaraman Institute of Technology. They have gone far ahead. They got a best AUV design award in IIT Indore when they had gone and presented, and they were approached by the industry. They also went ahead in working with forest officials to have a cleanup program on plastic, because plastic reaches ocean. We also work on marine plastic. It's a big menace. So they wanted to communicate and start from the water bodies, rivers, and lakes. And in start with that, they had gone and approached and they did the cleanup program. Thanks to students and the management who have taken initiative. So it's all, if you look at it, completely multifaceted. And we are doing for a common cause, bringing all together with a common platform where you can get connected to the people. And next is on what are the opportunities we have. You can register yourself. And today we have brought in school students to make them to understand. We will select few of them. MTS board has agreed to give few selected students to 1 year membership free. By $25, you'll become member. Later on, you can become regular member to understand and communicate. Even you take any other profession, you still have an expert mentor sitting over there who will interact with you in understanding your ideas. How do you develop ideas into product and serves to the society? That's what we are aiming at. And in the case of scholarships, you would have seen about 9 students getting about 30,000 worth of scholarship in the last 3 years. It's really amazing. This selection of this scholarship is not simple. This is a complicated process. There are juries sitting in different part of US and many other places. Your application gets through that. I'm very glad 9 students from our own country, from these student section who are members, could get the benefit, each of them over $3,000 and $2,500. For their own support, it's not for any other activity. But again, thanks to them, today also, this year also, we have announced, whoever had missed out, you can approach me. I recommend all of you to apply. In that, a specific scholarship we could evolve in the name of one Dr. Vembu Subramaniam. He worked in IIT Madras, and he was, later on, he was served in ISRO. Subsequently, he went to US. He was there 20 years. Unfortunately, in an accident on fine morning, an unfortunate day on January 23rd, 2 years ago, he passed away in a road accident where his car got fire. So we took up this matter and went to the board to institute a special MTS Vembu scholarship for our own students. It's about $5,000, $2,500 for two students. It's not only for your mark, it's for activity like what you do. It's like activity like how do you go to schools and how do you interact with them. So basically for undergrad and postgrad students, please visit. I'm recommending all of you to apply for that because that is exclusively for Indian students. We should not miss it in future. So in that also, again, last 2 years, we have been getting good response. So with these few words, I am really thanking all of you, particularly the organizers, school students. This is even for school students. There's a good program for you to see around IIT Madras and also to meet the toppers. I'm sure that you'll have a good memory. It's a memorable experience. Yourself, you should go everywhere to remember that when you go back to your schools and say that, yes, I've gone to IIT Madras. I was in that day on a first March. I will never forget in my life. Thanks a lot. Thanks to everyone. Thanks to everyone who ever respond to our call and come over here for this common cause of serving society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the insights about the Marine Technological Society India section insights. I would now request Professor Monica Agarwal to address the audience.
Good morning again. MTS is actually unique. As Dr. Venkatesh has said, it's unique. It is inviting students to a conference, which I've never seen in my life of a career of almost 40 years. School students coming and participating and interacting with IIT professors or even the students is a unique in itself. You are designing something, a school expo is there, and your models are like displayed there only. But this is an opportunity we get. See, in the world, it's just awareness. How do we get to know the society? And how do we use the opportunities that we get? There are many opportunities. As Dr. Venkateshan has said, there are opportunities for awards, scholarships. But there is no mentor. When I was a student, I was studying. I belong to a very small town. I didn't know even a JEE exist. When I was writing my 10th board, there was no Google. So I didn't know the JEE is there. And what is an IIT? Then somebody said, you should try for IIT. Then I went down and searched some abbreviation form, and then I got to know this is Indian Institute of Technology. But I do not want youngsters to do that. I'm sure none of us have those things nowadays. The Google is there. But Google has so much information. One should not be lost. So you need a mentor. A mentor is required to shape you, to make you a man. You are just born a child. Parents are there. Teachers are there. They help you to a level. This institute is making a further. In IIT, we always say a boy comes and a man goes out. Because after an IIT graduate, you'll become a responsible citizen of a world. You start contributing to the society. So now we want to lay down these things from the school itself. That's what the MTS is doing. That's what this TechSame is doing. Basically, this expo that we have, thanks to all the organizers for pulling out the kids from the school. I know the parents must be having a hard time. The boards are going on. 10th, 12th are busy. Then they have their own entrance. But still, this is important. See, now I stand here and I look back. My 10th board is important, but not that. See, it's how much I know. How much I know the systems and how much I can apply to a practical thing. That's what it's matter. I might be in my college. I have some 10-pointer students. But if I ask them to make a system which works, people fail. So it is important for all of us not to study, but to implement also. To do practical things which makes you realizable. In the life, see, it's a product which sells. It's like what you can sell is what is a product. What you know is your knowledge. So you should be a combination of both, a knowledge and a product. With that, I thank all the organizers, Dr. Venkateshan, Commander Ashok on the dais, and all the audience over here, and the organizer for having this wonderful event. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I would now request Commander S. Ashok to deliver the inaugural lecture. address.
Respected Dr. R. Venkateshan, Chairman MTS, Professor Monica Agarwal, distinguished guests, faculty members, eminent scientists, scholars, teachers, and bright young students. It's an honor for me to be here present to address such a young and bright audience. At the outset, I would like to thank the Chairman MTS India, the MTS Student Section of IIT Chennai, for inviting me to this symposium as chief guest, and I again deeply honor the statement. Now, I just want to be slightly interactive with the students. I see a lot of students here. I just want to know what they understand something called as marine technology. Can you say something about it? The student there, just to understand what is the enthusiasm, what brings you here, what you all are expecting from here. Please. So, you see, that itself, a kid can stand up and say what is in our mind and speak so courageously about something which we are still searching what is marine technology about. Very good. I congratulate the teachers and the school for at least imbibing such knowledge, such passion for something to do in future for the country and for themselves. I would like to hear something from the college students. I don't know who are the college students. Everyone looks like school student only. Somebody? Somebody from the college? Nobody? Okay, anyway, I'm very glad. What's your good name? Thank you, Swati, for telling what you feel like about marine technology. Anyway, marine technology as a whole is a very complex science, and advancement and the technology and its rightful application is what MTS is striving or thriving to become. And in this field, MTS has done a wonderful job and is doing a yeoman service in the field of marine technology. They are actually bringing the business, the industrialists, the educationalists, the scholars, the students, and they are trying to bring a synergy so that we can all work towards the advancement in marine technology, which can be used to advancement of a country. Actually, in marine technology, if you see, our country is just the developing stage and they yet to achieve the height which other developed countries have achieved. So this kind of symposium, this kind of interactions with eminent personalities, scholars, and what they teach you is what will make you think in a positive way and bring you to the kind of passion which will drive you to do better for the society and for the country and for yourself in the future. I find this students nowadays, the students or whatever, they marine technology is still a very complex subject where people are slightly worried. Ki, what to do? What will I do with marine technology? I don't understand. If I want to tell marine technology in one simple term, it is one technology or it is one subject where you have to put your mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, computer science, whatever. You have to put everything together to come winner in marine technology. So it is a combination of everything, and that is what makes marine technology such unique. And I'm sure that ki, everyone will agree with this. And as I look at these young, bright participants, students in the backdrop of this fine institution, and the quality of papers presented here, the future of marine technology in a country seems to be in good hands and can only get better from here on. Today, actually, our nation is an emerging power, be it in terms of economic progress, global influence, or military capabilities. In the last few decades, the government has given great impetus towards indigenization, and this indigenization is what is going to carry our country forward. And this marine technology has to be indigenous completely so that we don't depend on foreign countries for all our marine usages. This will happen only if the youngsters sitting here can interact and take useful values and guidance from the eminent scholars here and take it forward for development of indigenous products, which is going to take our country forward. Actually, in the last 20 odd years what I spent in Navy, I have seen our Navy grow from strength to strength, be it whether designing our own ships, which is actually only very few countries have got that capabilities, and I'm proud to say that we are one of them. Basically, we are the only probably developing nation which has got these capabilities. The construction, we construct our own ships. That is a massive, massive leap forward in technology. And technological advancement that come in communication, like what Professor Monica Agarwal and the other lecturer about acoustics are told, these are the one which has improved our fighting capabilities, which makes our sea secure and country secure. So this could be achieved only when we, as a Navy and the eminent scientists and the scholars, have come together, put collective effort and achieved this. And this is just in nascent stage, and we urge all the students and all these people to come together and take this thing forward so that even the armed forces can benefit from this. Marine technology is not only about marine pollution or advancement in communication, it is also about improving your security of the country, improving your armed forces capabilities. So that is also very important, which I would like you to take in mind. And whatever advancement we made, and not to rest on laurels, I urge the young minds here to dream big and strive to achieve them. Take your ideas and innovation to the next level and work hard to enable implementation of those ideas. That is what is more important. You might have a lot of ideas, you might have a lot of innovation. Like Professor told, till the time you don't implement it, it's of no use. So what you have to see is, whatever ideas and innovation, please try to implement it. And that implementation will come through what MTS is doing today to us. MTS is basically bridging the gap between the students, the scholars, industries, and the final implementation. So I should thank the chairman for facilitating such kind of symposium, which will improve this and bridge the gap, which is large in the society now. Students, you are the future of a great country. Your bright and cheerful faces, the sparkle in the eyes, and the fiery passion, that is what is going to drive our country forward. And I'm sure that marine technology is in a better hand, and we are going to go leaps and bounds in the future. I must say that marine technology is playing a big part in providing a wonderful platform in the form of TechSim for industry and the institution to come together and showcase various ideas and developments in marine technology. Once again, I take this opportunity to convey my hearty congratulations to all the participants in advance who are going to the winners, and for others, still urge, work hard and ensure that you become a better person and do whatever best you can do for your country. And with this, I wish a grand success to the students here of IIT Delhi, IIT Chennai, sorry, who have organized this wonderful function, and to continue with that so that we can do more functions like this. To conclude, I once again thanks the MTS student section of IIT Chennai for giving me an opportunity to witness some great minds at work and some good and bright students who have come here to participate. All the best, do well, God bless you. Jai Hind, thank you.
Thank you, sir. We would now like to felicitate our guest on the dais today. We would request Dr. R. Venkateshan to felicitate Commander S. Ashok. And we'd like to request Dr. Venkateshan to felicitate Professor Monica Agarwal. I would now like to invite Ms. Neha Patil, member of IIT Madras MTS student section, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable dignitaries, guests, faculty members, staff, participants for various events, representatives from various friends from media, and dear colleagues, it's my privilege to propose vote of thanks for this first national level TechSim 2020 on behalf of organizing committee TechSim and the entire fraternity of Department of Ocean Engineering. First of all, I extend my most sincere thanks to the chief guest, Commander S. Ashok, for accepting our invitation and for his gracious presence in spite of his busy schedule. I would like to take opportunity to thank Dr. Venkateshan, Chairman MTS India Section, Professor Monica Agarwal, Professor K. Murli, Head Department of Ocean Engineering, our beloved faculty advisor, Professor Sanasi Raj, our Professor Vijay Kumar, Professor Krishnakuti sir, for the presence. I place my thanks to all the faculty members of Department of Ocean Engineering. Thanks to all the participants who have come from various parts of the nation. Thanks to school students and administration for their active participation in the Science Expo. I would like to place my heartfelt thanks to each and every sponsor of TechSim 2020, which is Ministry of Earth Sciences, NORINCO, IAR, L&D Defense, Indomar, Sun Technologies, Samita Marine, Electronic Lab, NIOT, NCCR, ASB Systems, MTES, that is Marine Technology Society, and NTCPWC. My sincere thanks to all the MTS counselors and students, volunteers for their support and cooperation. Thanks everyone. Now I would like to request you all to stand for National Anthem. Thank you. So now we'll take a small tea break. I request all the dignitaries and the participants to go to the main dining hall for the small tea break of just 10 minutes, and then we'll have a breakfast for school students in the annex hall. Also, as we are running out of time, I request you all to be quick. We'll assemble for poster session in hall 2, and we'll assemble for panel discussion in hall 3. It will be a parallel session. And before leaving for the tea break, I request you all to assemble here for a group photo.